The Amazon rainforest is one of the most biodiverse places on Earth. So how does this place rely on one of the most barren, dry places on Earth, the Sahara Desert? In this video, I will be going over how dust from this desert fuels life in the Amazon rainforest and what this rainforest might look like without the input of dust from the Sahara. The Amazon is the largest rainforest in the world. Likewise, the Sahara is the largest hot desert in the world. So, how does the Sahara Desert help maintain the incredible biodiversity in the Amazon rainforest? Well, it's all in the dust. Every year, enormous dust plumes arise from the Sahara sand dunes and travel across the Atlantic Ocean to the Americas. Much of the dust reaches the Amazon rainforest, and some even contributes to things like the red tide blooms off the coast of Florida. And in fact, this dust transport has all sorts of positive and negative impacts that I'll talk about later in the video. But how large a role does the dust transport from the Sahara play in maintaining the Amazon's life and biodiversity? Well, the major effects of this dust on the Amazon include nutrient input, fertilization, cloud formation, and biodiversity. So I'll talk about each one of those in that order now. First off, nutrient input. So the Sahara dust carries nutrients or minerals with nutrients like phosphorus, potassium, and iron minerals, which are then deposited in places like the Amazon. Phosphorus is vital for energy production and DNA synthesis in all life. We need phosphorus, microbes need phosphorus, plants need phosphorus, everything needs phosphorus. We actually use it to make what we call ATP, which is the energy of life. ATP stands for adenosine triphosphate because it's got phosphate in it, which has phosphorus in it. Because phosphorus is so necessary, but often tied up in rocks in the geosphere rather than available as dissolved phosphorus to uptake by plants and then eating by us, it is often the limiting nutrient in a lot of environments. And just making phosphorus more available fuels biological productivity and biodiversity like crazy. Potassium is also really important for life, as it's required for photosynthesis, water regulation, and nutrient transport. Iron is necessary for chlorophyll production and also, thus, photosynthesis, but iron is also required for nitrogen-fixing bacteria, which convert atmospheric nitrogen into nitrogen compounds that are usable by other life. For example, plants, which we then eat to get our nitrogen. And because these microbes are so essential for the nitrogen cycle, and nitrogen is so essential for all life, this iron within the dust is a really critical component that fuels life in the Amazon. So, because of these effects that the nutrient input has, basically the Sahara dust acts as a natural fertilizer for the Amazon rainforest. But these nutrients have to become available for plant uptake, like I talked about in my recent Why Microbes Are So Important video. Basically, to do this, the wind and rain have to distribute and deposit the dust across the Amazon on the soil, and soil microbes, which is why microbes are so important, have to convert these minerals that contain the potassium, phosphorus, and iron into bioavailable compounds. In other words, compounds that are like dissolved in water and available for plants to uptake. And plants then have to take them up through structures like root hairs that allow them to absorb water and dissolved nutrients within that water from the soil. So that's how the dust helps to fertilize the Amazon. But what are these nutrients within the Sahara dust to begin with? Sahara sand contains minerals like phosphates, potassium-containing feldspars and mica minerals, and iron-bearing hematite and magnetite minerals. All of these minerals are pretty common, and basically, the erosion of these minerals form fine sand, which then forms the sand dunes in the Sahara, which then can get transported as dust across the Atlantic. But during the dust transport, it can react with other airborne substances, which further incorporate trace elements and potentially more trace nutrients. Human activities in and around the Sahara actually also provide additional nutrients to the dust because, for example, fertilizers used in agriculture often contain lots of, nutrients like phosphorus and potassium and iron, and all of these things can then be added on to what the dust already contains, and those can then be transported as well. So yeah, fertilizers that are used in one part of the world might end up way over to the other side of the world, which is insane. The thing is, these nutrients can't really be used in the Sahara because there's no soil. There's no, well, there's microbes, but there's not like soil that has well-developed profile and soil microbes that break down nutrients and plants that then take up the nutrients. There's not a system, a soil environment that provides somewhere for these nutrients to be used in the Sahara, which is why they're not really beneficial to feeding biodiversity in the Sahara itself. But when they're carried over to some place that does have this soil, microbial, plant, and animal type of ecosystem, that is when they become useful. There's also relatively low nutrient availability within Amazonian soils to begin with. This region gets relatively heavy rainfall and constant rainfall, which is why it's called a rainforest. And this causes excessive leaching of nutrients from the soil. In other words, nutrients are, you know, soluble. They can be dissolved, which is why they can be taken up by plant roots, which is good. But if they're dissolved and then carried away, infiltrated down through the soil by the rain, they're leached out of the soil. They're leached out of the area where the plant roots can reach them. And that lowers the nutrient availability overall for the ecosystem within the Amazon rainforest. So the constant deposition of dust with extra nutrients helps to offset all the nutrients that it's losing through rain and leaching. It's also a really warm and humid climate with abundant and diverse life, which leads to the rapid decomposition of organic matter and cycling of organic matter within the ecosystem. In other words, all the dead leaf litter and everything that, you know, gets down to the soil surface gets decomposed by the abundant life in the Amazon so quickly that it can't really infiltrate the soil and become long-term, like, organic rich layer that is really, you know, nutrient rich and good for, you know, good plant growth, because it's just used up and cycled too quickly. So again, that constant input of dust with nutrients into the soil really helps to offset this lack of organic matter and lack of nutrients because of leaching. Also, there's really high competition within the Amazon. Again, it's not just a bioabundant place with a lot of plant and animal life, it's biodiverse, meaning there's not only a lot of life, but also really diverse life that is always competing for the same nutrients. So to have this constant input of nutrients is really important to feed this biodiversity and bioabundance. Sahara dust particles also induce cloud formation. They act as what's called cloud condensation nuclei, CCN, which provide surfaces for water vapor to condense around to form clouds. This can affect rainfall patterns within the Amazon region and provide a means for nutrient transport, dust from air to surface to infiltrate the soil. And the final major effect that the Sahara dust has on the Amazon is fueling its biodiversity. Now, the Amazon is one of the most biodiverse places on planet Earth. And this is due to a lot of factors, including diverse habitats like lowland tropical forests, floodplains, upland forests, savannas, and river systems. These habitats support different plant and animal species, and consistent rainfall, which promotes continuous plant growth, which has been estimated at around 390 billion individual trees with over 16,000 different species of trees, and that supports, again, really biodiverse animal life. The Amazon River creates diverse ecosystems, including riverbanks, flooded forests, and oxbow lakes. And the amount of time that the Amazon has been around for millions of years has allowed these species to not only, you know, evolve here, but adapt to distinct ecological niches and form all sorts of biodiverse niches within the region. Also, surprisingly, the low nutrient availability in Amazon soils has actually led to higher biodiversity. This is because in nutrient-poor soils, no single species can dominate like in nutrient-rich soils, allowing a variety of plant species to coexist, and low nutrient availability forces plants to kind of develop unique and diverse adaptations to, you know, get the best out of the nutrients they have. So with all these factors in mind, it is not only the dust that fuels the biodiversity in the Amazon rainforest. It is a lot of factors, and the dust is just one component. But the dust does provide nutrient input that helps support the survival and diversity of the plant animal species in the rainforest, and it helps to maintain that complex web of life in the rainforest. It also helps to offset the low nutrient availability like we talked about earlier. So what would the Amazon look like if there was no Sahara dust input? Without the dust from the Sahara, the availability of phosphorus, potassium, and iron would likely be significantly reduced, leading to more nutrient deficiency on top of what the low nutrient availability already is like in the Amazon. This would likely lead to different plant communities and reduced overall biomass. But potentially more biodiversity, considering that low nutrient availability, you know, promoted biodiversity in the Amazon rainforest to begin with, but it's hard to say because it's hard to actually, we haven't fully quantified the effect of the Sahara dust yet on the Amazon. So we really don't know to what degree it, you know, fuels biodiversity or, you know, hinders it. It's hard to say because it's such a complex, you know, various amount of factors working together. If, however, it did alter the plant communities quite a bit, this would also lead to different and likely less overall animal life. The lack of dust from the Sahara also might affect the hydrological cycle of the Amazon, given the dust particles' role as CCNs or cloud condensation nuclei. But if this did decrease the amount of rain the Amazon got, it might actually balance out the nutrient deficiency caused by the lack of dust, because less rain would also mean less leaching of nutrients out of the soil. So overall, maybe the nutrient availability really wouldn't change much if the dust stopped coming, because maybe even though it caused less nutrient input, it would also cause less rain and less leaching. So it's hard to say again. But you might be wondering, since the Sahara dust has positive effects on the Amazon, can we just deposit dust elsewhere to, you know, reap these positive effects elsewhere on Earth? So the short answer is no. We technically already do this because remember, the Amazon dust kind of acts as a fertilizer, and we have done this. We have fertilizers and we do use them to increase the plant growth in, you know, regions like agricultural regions. But unfortunately, we've over-fertilized to the point where, well, we've overdone a lot of agricultural things to the point where we're killing, you know, soil microbes and stuff, which, you know, I talk about in, I think, my carbon sequestration video, which I'll link to the top right if you're interested. But we've over-fertilized to the point of also causing ocean anoxia. So, for example, when we over-fertilize in the U.S., the runoff goes into the coast where all these polka dots, these red dots are, which are labeled hypoxic areas because this coast has now been so, you know, infiltrated with extra nutrients that it's caused what's called eutrophication to the ocean margin areas along that coast because the input of too much nutrients like nitrogen, phosphorus, which is contained within our fertilizers, leads to blooms, algal blooms, which then lead to oxygen depletion beneath the blooms because the oxygen is all used up to decompose the algae from the bloom. So the oxygen depletion leads to what we call hypoxia, or in some cases even anoxia, which is low and no oxygen respectively. And these are really harmful for animal life because obviously no oxygen leads to no marine animals, no fish. Fish need oxygen. All the animals in the ocean need oxygen, just like animals on land. So this lack of oxygen along these, you know, ocean margins because of over-fertilization is not good. Overall, Sahara dust not only has positive impacts like it has on the Amazon, but also negative impacts like I talked about earlier, not only on the environment, but also human health. Dust, for example, deteriorates air quality, which is not great for, you know, our health. Dust can also cause haze and reduce visibility, impacting aviation and transportation, Large dust events can also influence regional and global climate by scattering and absorbing solar radiation, affecting temperature patterns and cloud formation, which, doesn't necessarily mean negative right away, but it could be a negative effect. It depends on what altitude the dust is at, what, density the dust is at, what size the particles are, their composite. All it depends on a lot of things to how it'll affect climate, the dust events. For example, one positive way that Sahara dust can affect weather is inhibiting the development and intensification of hurricanes. But dust deposition can also lead to coral bleaching, which is another negative impact because it reduces light penetration. And the reason corals bleach, they're not dying per se, but they can die if they're bleached for too long because what they have is a symbiotic relationship with photosynthetic algae that live in the coral skeleton, and this algae provides them food. And when the algae doesn't get light to photosynthesize, or when the algae doesn't like the temperature because it's getting too hot, they will expel from the coral. And when they leave, the coral is bleached, and the coral cannot live without its algae friends for very long. Sahara dust can also increase the rate of glacial melting because when it's deposited on ice and snow surfaces, it darkens those surfaces, causing more absorption of solar radiation. And like I mentioned earlier, the iron content of the dust can stimulate phytoplankton blooms, in other words, harmful algal blooms in the ocean, which can influence marine and nearby terrestrial ecosystems. For example, the red tide scenarios can be very harmful because they produce harmful toxins that kill fish and can get in the air and harm human health. And the iron content from the dust can fuel these again because a lot of them need iron to fix nitrogen. And then the nitrogen fuels more, of that life because that's a major nutrient. So overall, the dust can have very negative impacts, but also very positive impacts, clearly, like it has on the Amazon rainforest. But if you want to know more about the history of the Saharan Desert, I suggest you check out this recent video I did on the history of the Sahara Desert, for example, when it was green or even when it was covered in ice. So, with that, guys, my references are linked down below in the description box, like always, and I will see you guys in the next one. Bye!